Welcome to Adult Sleep Stories. Finding moments of peace in the hustle and bustle of our lives can be a big challenge. Our channel is your sanctuary, a place where captivating tales blend with soothing tones, guiding you toward restful slumber. Escape from the noise, let go of the day's stresses, and allow our stories to transport you to realms of tranquility and dreams. Whether you're seeking relaxation, meditation, or simply a good night's sleep, you're in the right place. So, settle in, close your eyes, and let the journey to serenity begin. In our unceasing journey through the corridors of life, moments of pure, unadulterated tranquility can sometimes seem as elusive as shadows at noon. The modern world is a symphony of endless noises, from the incessant hum of digital screens to the ceaseless whispers of obligations, commitments, and desires. In this symphony, our souls often search for a gentle lullaby, a melodious escape, a chance to pause, breathe, and simply be. Now, as you find yourself here in the magic of this narrative oasis, know that you've stumbled upon a sanctuary, a world where serenity isn't just a luxury but a promise. Picture, if you will, a secluded haven nestled amidst nature's embrace, where the wind hums lullabies and time itself seems to tread lightly. This is where we invite you to journey with us, a place of meditation, reflection, and utter calm. Begin by taking a deep, resolute breath. Feel the cool air grace your nostrils, traveling through the depths of your lungs, filling your being with the ancient rhythms of existence. And then, as you exhale, imagine releasing the shackles of worry, stress, and the relentless march of time. Each subsequent breath is a step deeper into the heart of tranquility, a dance with the universe, an affirmation of the present moment. We live in an era where the very essence of our existence often feels fragmented. Pulled in myriad directions by demands, expectations, and the invisible threads of technology, it's easy to lose oneself. But these tales, each a gem sculpted from the rich tapestries of imagination and insight, seek to offer you a bridge. A bridge not just to sleep, but that in itself is a cherished realm of restoration, but to a state of soulful relaxation, where the world narrows down to the here and now, where every heartbeat is a reminder of life's simple beauties. These stories are not just words. They are portals. They beckon you into worlds where the pace is gentler, the colors more vivid, and the sounds harmoniously aligned with the rhythms of the cosmos. Here, amidst these tales, you'll find characters and landscapes that resonate with the deepest parts of your psyche, invoking a sense of familiarity and nostalgia. They're like old friends or forgotten dreams, waiting to welcome you back. As you immerse yourself in these narratives, let the outside world fade into soft focus. Envision your stresses and anxieties as leaves carried away by a gentle stream, disappearing beyond the horizon. Let the weight of expectation, the clamor of responsibilities, and the noise of uncertainty be replaced by the soothing cadences of these stories. Every word, every phrase, is a brushstroke painting a world of peace, inviting you to step in and explore. Sleep, that precious gift, is not just a physical necessity but a balm for the soul. It's nature's way of healing, restoring, and rejuvenating. As you stand at the threshold of dreams, these tales are the gentle hands guiding you towards restful slumber. They remind you of the beauty of surrender, of letting go, of drifting into the comforting embrace of night. So, dear listener, as you embark on this journey with us, know that you are not alone. Through the magic of these tales, we are with you, sharing in your quest for tranquility and deep, restorative sleep. Let these stories be your anchor, your lighthouse, guiding you away from the tempests of daily life and into the calm waters of relaxation and dreams. Welcome to our sanctuary. Let the journey to serenity begin. The Relics of the Knights Templar. Chapter 1. Whispers of the Past. The golden rays of the afternoon sun filtered through the stained glass windows of the Templar Archive in London, casting vibrant mosaics of light across the dusty air. Dr. Elizabeth Harding's silhouette was just another shadow among the many that danced on the walls, lined with ancient tomes and artifacts that had withstood the ravages of time. Elizabeth, a respected archaeologist known for her expertise in medieval history, felt a familiar thrill run through her as she stood at the precipice of a new adventure. This archive was a trove of knowledge, rumored to hold the keys to many secrets, including those of the enigmatic Knights Templar. The order had once been a formidable force, a network of warrior monks who amassed wealth and power before falling from grace under the shadow of scandal and heresy. She brushed her fingers over the leather spines of the books, each one a sentinel guarding the truths of a bygone era. Her quest was to uncover the final resting place of the Templar relics, treasures that had sparked the imagination and avarice of many before her. Yet, where they sought gold and jewels, Elizabeth sought knowledge, the true treasure. Her pursuit had led her here, based on a whisper of a lead found tucked within the personal letters of a Templar knight. These letters spoke of a collection of relics, which the Templars had gone to great lengths to hide after their order's dissolution. The authenticity of the letters was still under scrutiny by her peers, but for Elizabeth, they were a siren's call. As the day aged, the archive's curator, Mr. Thompson, approached her with a gentle cough. He was an elderly gentleman, with silver hair and a face etched with the wisdom of years spent amongst these relics of history. "Dr. Harding," he began, his voice a soft rumble, "I brought you the ledger you requested. It's quite delicate, I'm afraid. The pages might not withstand much handling." Elizabeth accepted the leather-bound ledger with a nod, laying it carefully on a reading pillow. The ledger's pages were a patchwork of inks and scripts, a record of transactions and movements that would appear mundane to the untrained eye. But Elizabeth was searching for patterns, anomalies that hinted at something more than routine logistics. Hours passed as she meticulously examined each entry. Her eyes were keen, missing nothing, until at last they were drawn to a particular notation. The entry was dated, curiously, years after the official disbandment of the Templar Order, referencing a small chapel in Scotland known as Rosslyn. Rosslyn was rumored to be a place of great significance to the Templars, its very architecture a puzzle of esoteric knowledge and hermetic wisdom. The ledger mentioned a statue of a knight, guarding the entrance to the heart, an enigmatic phrase that suggested more than mere decoration. Elizabeth mused over the meaning, her thoughts racing with possibilities. The heart could signify the inner sanctum where the Templars would have prayed, or perhaps it was metaphorical, indicating a repository of their most sacred possessions. With this clue etched into her memory, Elizabeth prepared for her journey to Rosslyn. She bid Mr. Thompson goodbye, her mind already mapping out the route she would take to Scotland. The curator offered her a word of caution, a reminder that the path of the Templars was fraught with enigmas and that their secrets were often protected by layers of allegories and traps meant to deter the unworthy. Unperturbed, Elizabeth stepped out of the archive and into the cool embrace of the evening. The city was alive with the hum of traffic and the murmur of pedestrians, a stark contrast to the quietude she left behind. She paused for a moment, closing her eyes, allowing herself a moment of stillness amidst the chaos. When she opened them again, her gaze was steadfast. The journey to Rosslyn would take her across the rolling green landscape of the English countryside and into the heart of Scotland. Her transportation was arranged swiftly, the anticipation building with each passing mile. She reviewed her notes, the information from the ledger committed to memory, but she knew that intuition would guide her as much as intellect in the days to come. Upon arrival, Rosslyn Chapel loomed before her, a marvel of Gothic architecture nestled in the Scottish lowlands. It was late evening, and the chapel was closed to visitors, giving her a few precious hours to settle into her accommodation and prepare for the exploration set for dawn. That night, Elizabeth lay in her bed at a small and just a stone's throw from the chapel, her mind a carousel of images and theories. She envisioned the knight statue mentioned in the ledger, its stony gaze guarding the entrance to the heart of the chapel. What secrets did it keep? What history lay concealed beneath its marble facade? As sleep finally claimed her, she dreamt of hidden chambers and the echo of Templar chants, of shadows moving in the dim light of torches. Her dream was a tapestry woven from the threads of anticipation and the yarns of history, a prelude to the discoveries that awaited her with the coming of the light. The first light of dawn was a gentle caress on the horizon when Elizabeth set out for Rosslyn Chapel. She was the first to arrive, her presence a silent footfall on the dew-kissed grass. The key to the chapel's front gate was entrusted to her by the local custodian, a privilege granted to few. As she unlocked the gate and pushed the heavy door open, the chapel welcomed her with an air of expectation. The interior was a forest of stone, each column and arch a branch that held the weight of centuries. The air was cool and still, the only sound the soft whisper of her breath and the distant call of a waking bird. Elizabeth's eyes were drawn immediately to the statue of the knight. It was as the ledger described, majestic, its marble surface worn by time, standing sentinel at the base of an elaborate pillar. It was then that she noticed something peculiar. The knight's hands were not in the usual prayer or combat position typical of such effigies. Instead, one hand pointed subtly downward, towards the base of the pillar itself. Heart racing, Elizabeth approached the statue, her hands hesitating before tracing the lines carved into the stone. It was a puzzle waiting to be solved, a silent guardian holding the key to the next step of her quest. As her fingers moved over the surface, she felt the subtle give of a mechanism long dormant. With a breath held tight in her chest, she pressed down. The stone beneath her fingers moved imperceptibly, and a low grinding sound echoed through the chapel. A section of the floor, nearly imperceptible from the rest, began to shift, revealing a narrow stairway spiraling downward into darkness. Elizabeth stood on the brink of discovery, the first light of dawn casting long shadows across the chapel floor. It was an invitation to descend into the depths of history, to uncover the truths of the Templar Order that had been lost to the world. Taking a lantern in hand, she stepped onto the staircase, the cool whisper of ancient stone greeting her as she began her descent. The light from above dimmed with each step, the darkness ahead promising revelations and, perhaps, the discovery of the Templar relics she had dedicated her life to finding. And so, the first chapter of Elizabeth's journey closed as she ventured into the shadows beneath Rosslyn Chapel, each step a bridge between the present and the enigmatic past of the Knights Templar. The quest for their relics was more than a search for material wealth. It was a journey into the very soul of history, a path that now lay open at her feet. Chapter 2. Beneath the Stones of Rosslyn. The spiraling staircase seemed to Elizabeth like descending through the vertebrae of time itself, each step taking her further into the bowels of the earth and deeper into the past. The air grew cooler and denser, heavy with the scent of damp stone and ancient secrets. She steadied her lantern, casting its halo against the darkness that clung to every corner like a shroud. As she descended, the silence of the subterranean world enveloped her, a stark contrast to the rustling leaves and mourning calls of birds she had left above. The only sounds were her steady breaths and the occasional drip of water from the chapel's stone ceiling, its rhythm a heartbeat within the earth's chest. The staircase ended abruptly, opening into a chamber so vast that her lantern light seemed to falter before the oppressive darkness. The edges of the chamber stretched beyond her sight, suggesting an expanse that was both grand and intimidating. Elizabeth's first steps into the chamber were tentative, her eyes straining to pierce the gloom. The beam from her lantern swept over the chamber walls, revealing carvings that whispered tales of battles, martyrdom, and celestial reverence. There were scenes of knights on horseback, their swords raised in holy fervor, and quiet moments of prayer within the solitude of monastic cells. The floor was a mosaic of stone tiles, some plain, others inlaid with the symbols of the Templar Order, the cross patee, the lamb bearing the flag, the two knights upon a single horse, emblems of their sacred duty and humble beginnings. Elizabeth wondered if these images were mere decoration or if they were part of a larger puzzle leading to the relics. As she explored the periphery of the chamber, her attention was drawn to a prominent altar at the far end, bathed in shadows. She approached it with reverence, her heart thrumming with the sense of approaching something momentous. The altar was adorned with a faded tapestry, woven with threads that had once been vibrant but now were muted with age. The image depicted was that of the Ark of the Covenant, a symbol of divine communion and an artifact long associated with Templar myth. Below the tapestry, resting upon the altar, lay a collection of objects, a chalice, a broken sword, a tattered banner, and a stone tablet inscribed with Latin text. These were not the storied relics she had hoped to find, but they were undoubtedly significant. The broken sword could be a fragment of the legendary sword of the Templar Grandmasters, each piece a chapter of the Order's turbulent history. The Latin inscription was a biblical verse, its words resonating with Elizabeth's own quest, Quare et invenitis, or seek, and ye shall find. The message was clear, a beckoning to those who dared to delve deeper into the mysteries of the Templars. The chalice was of particular interest. It was simple in design, lacking the opulence one might expect from a cup associated with holy rites or the fabled Holy Grail. Yet, there was an aura of significance about it, as if it had been held by countless hands, each imparting a piece of their soul into its metal. Elizabeth documented each item with care, taking photographs and notes, her mind already cataloging and cross-referencing with the extensive knowledge she held of Templar artifacts. She wrapped the more delicate items and placed them carefully into her satchel, ensuring their preservation for further study. Her examination was thorough, but the true objective of her search, the Templar relics of legend, remained elusive. Elizabeth considered the possibility that the chamber was but an antechamber, a waiting room before the inner sanctum. It was then that her light glinted off something embedded in the wall behind the altar. It was a seal, circular in shape, with the familiar design of two knights on a horse. The seal did not match the stonework of the chamber. It was a later addition, a lock of sorts. Elizabeth's pulse quickened. She knew that Templar seals were often used to denote sanctioned repositories or to mark the presence of something worth safeguarding. Circling the altar, she found that the stone floor had an almost imperceptible seam, suggesting the presence of a hidden passage. The mechanism to open it was not immediately apparent, but Elizabeth had learned to see beyond the obvious in her years of fieldwork. She returned her attention to the seal, examining its edges and the space around it. With gentle pressure and a combination of turns, she felt the subtle release of ancient gears. The ground beneath her feet trembled faintly as a section of the stone floor receded, revealing a staircase even narrower and steeper than the first. This new descent was a mirror into the past, a passage that had been sealed for centuries. With each step, Elizabeth felt the weight of history press upon her, a tangible reminder of the gravity of her search. The staircase ended not in a chamber but a corridor, lined with torch sconces and closed doors. The Templars, it seemed, had constructed an entire network beneath the chapel, a labyrinthine repository for their most sacred possessions. Elizabeth moved cautiously along the corridor, her heart in her throat. Each door she passed was a mystery, each turn a new verse in the silent hymn of the past. The air was thick with the scent of old wood and the metallic tang of iron. It was here, in the veiled quietude of the Templar catacombs, that she felt closest to her goal. Hours slipped by unnoticed as she explored the passageways, her meticulous nature refusing to leave any stone unturned, any door unopened. She encountered rooms filled with parchments, ceremonial garb, and more cryptic carvings, each discovery a piece of the puzzle she was slowly assembling. And it was in the deepest part of the catacombs, past a door that seemed to have been untouched for an age, that she found it, a room that pulsed with an energy that was almost palpable. The walls were lined with chests, their contents shielded from prying eyes by locks of intricate design. It was within these chests, Elizabeth knew, that she would find the Templar relics she had been seeking, the objects that had sparked wars, inspired faith, and ignited imaginations throughout the centuries. Her hands trembled as she prepared to break the seals, a mixture of fear and exhilaration coursing through her veins. The quest that had begun with whispered legends and ancient texts was reaching its zenith. Each chest opened was an unveiling of history, a revelation of truths long concealed. And as Elizabeth stood amidst the treasures of the Templars, she realized that her journey was not just about the relics themselves, but about unearthing the enduring legacy of the Order, a legacy that now rested in her hands. The chapter concluded with Elizabeth, alone in the stillness beneath Rosslyn Chapel, surrounded by the remnants of a bygone era. The journey ahead would be one of preservation and revelation as she prepared to bring the secrets of the Templars into the light of the modern world. Chapter 3: The Shadow of the Templar. The morning mist had barely lifted from the rolling hills of the French countryside when Elizabeth's journey brought her to the crumbling remains of what was once a Templar stronghold. The air was crisp, carrying the scent of earth and old stone. As she walked through the archway of what must have been a grand entrance, she could almost hear the echoes of armored footsteps and solemn vows. This desolate ruin, reclaimed by nature over centuries, had been a vital node in the Templar network, rumored to house a crypt below that safeguarded relics of profound power and significance. Elizabeth's fingers traced the moss-covered stones, feeling the pulse of history in each crevice and crack. There was a reverence here, a solemn atmosphere that commanded silence and respect. She unpacked her tools with care, setting up a workstation amongst the debris. Her map of the compound, recreated from various historical texts and recent satellite imagery, pointed to a chapel as the likely entrance to the crypt. The chapel's roof had long since fallen, leaving its interior exposed to the elements. Its altar, however, had survived, standing defiant against the passage of time. As Elizabeth began her examination, she noticed the intricate carvings on the altar's side, which were not immediately visible due to the overgrowth. They depicted scenes of the Last Supper, the Knights Crusades, and a series of coded inscriptions that the Templars were known for. The latter was a complex sequence of geometric shapes and numbers that suggested a cipher. It was while she was analyzing these symbols that she discovered the trigger, a hidden catch beneath the altar that, when pressed, revealed a narrow stairway leading down into darkness. The stairway spiraled deep beneath the earth, the air growing colder with each step. Elizabeth's breath became visible, her heartbeat a steady drum in her ears. Below, the crypt was more intact than she had dared to hope. The vaulted ceilings were adorned with frescoes depicting angelic figures and apocalyptic scenes, a silent testimony to the Templar's religious zeal and apocalyptic anxieties. The walls held niches where statues of saints once stood, now empty or filled with broken remnants, and in the center of the crypt was a stone sarcophagus, its lid carved with the image of a knight in repose, his hands folded over the hilt of a sword that rested upon his chest. Elizabeth approached with a mixture of excitement and reverence. It was common for Templar knights to be buried with objects of personal significance that were sometimes mistaken for greater relics. The sarcophagus lid was heavy, and it took her considerable effort to slide it open. Inside, the remains of the knight were surprisingly well preserved, clothed in the remnants of a ceremonial robe. Around his neck was a chain from which hung a simple cross, untouched by time. It was the cross that drew Elizabeth's attention. It was made of a metal she couldn't immediately identify, with a warm hue that suggested a mixture of gold and another, unknown element. She lifted the cross with care, feeling a jolt of energy at her fingertips. The cross was warm, and it seemed to vibrate with a frequency that resonated with the various stones of the crypt. Elizabeth knew she had found something extraordinary, something that transcended mere historical artifact. Her exploration continued, and she soon uncovered a series of trunks hidden in alcoves along the crypt's perimeter. They were sealed with the same cipher that she had encountered in the chapel above. Elizabeth, with her knowledge of Templar symbols and codes, set to work on the cipher. It was a delicate process, requiring patience and a keen mind. As she deciphered the code, Elizabeth realized that it was more than just a lock, it was a message. The Templars had left a warning for those who would venture this far. The message spoke of a burden of knowledge and a trial of the worthy, cryptic words that suggested the relics were not just protected by locks and stone but by a test of character and resolve. With the cipher solved, the trunks opened to reveal a trove of items, scrolls written in ancient languages, artifacts from the Holy Land, and items whose purpose was lost to time. Each piece was a testament to the Templars' reach and influence. Amongst the relics, one item stood out, a detailed ledger containing entries in a mix of Latin and a code that Elizabeth had never seen. The ledger detailed transactions, movements of goods, and, most intriguingly, entries that alluded to other hidden caches of Templar treasures. It was a roadmap to a greater mystery, one that spanned the globe. Elizabeth spent hours cataloging the items, taking photographs and notes, ensuring that nothing was disturbed more than necessary. She felt a growing sense of responsibility to safeguard this knowledge, to ensure that it was used wisely and respectfully. The legacy of the Templars was in her hands, and it was a heavy burden to bear. As the day waned, Elizabeth emerged from the crypt, the cross around her neck and the ledger secured in her bag. She knew that her discovery would shake the foundations of history and possibly the modern world. But she also knew that the true value of her find was not in gold or jewels, but in understanding the human drive for faith, knowledge, and power. The sun dipped below the horizon as she made her way back to her makeshift camp, the crypt and its secrets now a part of her own story. She prepared for the journey ahead, to delve deeper into the Templars' shadowy past and bring their hidden truths to light. This chapter of her life was far from over. It was merely the beginning of a greater saga that would challenge everything she knew about history, the Templars, and herself. Chapter 4. The Guardian's Secret. Elizabeth had barely slept, her mind alive with the images of the crypt and the weight of the Templar cross around her neck. As dawn's first light breached the horizon, she was already poring over the Templar ledger, her notes spread around her in a cocoon of scholarship and intrigue. Today's task was to uncover the meaning behind the code entries in the ledger. She suspected it contained the locations of other Templar relics, but the code was unlike any she had encountered. The symbols were a labyrinth of interlocking triangles, squares, and other geometric shapes, each likely representing a number or letter in a complex substitution cipher. As the sun climbed higher, Warming the stones of the ruin around her, Elizabeth made a breakthrough. The code was based on a medieval system of mathematics known as sacred geometry, reflecting the Templars' fascination with the divine nature of numbers and shapes. Each geometric figure corresponded to a numeric value that, in turn, could be translated into letters using a Templar cipher she had previously decoded. Piece by piece, the ledger began to yield its secrets. The entries spoke of a network of hidden vaults scattered across the world, each containing a piece of the Templar legacy. They were not merely hiding their treasures from their enemies, they were preserving their knowledge for a future generation deemed worthy to inherit it. As Elizabeth decoded the entries, a picture began to emerge of a Templar order far more advanced and mysterious than history had ever acknowledged. They had been protectors of not only the physical relics of Christendom, but also of knowledge that could change the understanding of history itself. The ledger mentioned a guardian, a role passed down through the centuries, an individual charged with keeping the secrets of the Templars safe. This guardian would know the locations of all the vaults and possess the keys to unlock them. The last entry in the ledger hinted that the current guardian resided in a monastery hidden in the Pyrenees Mountains, a place shrouded in legend and as elusive as the Templars themselves. Elizabeth packed her gear with renewed purpose. She would seek out this guardian and unlock the next chapter of this unfolding mystery. The journey to the Pyrenees would be treacherous, crossing not only rugged terrain but also the shadowy lines of those who would keep the Templar secrets buried. As she trekked through the landscapes of France toward the towering Pyrenees, Elizabeth encountered locals whose stories and superstitions about the Templars added layers to her understanding. In the villages, they spoke of a knight who walks without a shadow, a figure that protected a sacred treasure. Children grew up with tales of the Templars' hidden riches, but Elizabeth knew the true treasure was the knowledge the Templars guarded. After several days of travel, she found herself at the foot of a mountain, cloaked in swirling mists and a silence that seemed to resonate with hidden depth. A narrow, winding path led up into the clouds, toward a monastery that matched the description in the ledger. It was an imposing structure, built into the mountain itself, as if grown from the very rock. The monks welcomed her with a quiet nod, accustomed to silence and solitude. Elizabeth sensed that they knew why she had come, and they regarded her with a mixture of curiosity and caution. She was led to a small, Spartan chamber to rest before meeting the abbot. The abbot was a man of indeterminate age, his face carved with the lines of countless smiles and worries. When she mentioned the Templar ledger, his eyes flickered with recognition. He led her to a private chamber, where he revealed himself to be the guardian the ledger spoke of. The abbot explained that the Templars foresaw the persecution that would come and took steps to protect their knowledge. He told her of a prophecy that spoke of a scholar with a seeker's heart who would come to claim the Templars' legacy when the world was ready for its truths. Elizabeth was that scholar, the abbot believed. He handed her a small, intricately carved box, the key to the Templar vaults. Within it were individual keys, each uniquely designed to open a single vault. The locations of these vaults were not on any map, they were etched into Elizabeth's mind through the tales of the ledger and the guidance of the abbot. With the keys in her possession, Elizabeth knew her journey had only just begun. She would seek out the vaults, uncover their secrets, and fulfill her role in the prophecy. Each vault held a piece of a puzzle that, when assembled, would reveal a history unknown, a wisdom lost to time, and a treasure beyond material wealth. The abbot's final words to her as she departed were cryptic yet clear: "Protect the knowledge as the Templars did before you, for its power is immense. Let it not fall into the hands of those who would use it for darkness." As Elizabeth descended the mountain, the monastery disappeared into the mist once more, as if it was never there at all. Ahead of her lay the world, her map filled not with locations but with possibilities, and each step was a step into the unknown, toward a secret that would illuminate the world. She ventured onward, the keys to the past jingling softly in her bag, a symphony of promise and peril, as the saga of the Templar relics continued to unfold with her as the new guardian of their ancient, enigmatic truths.